Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
Father, we just thank you for the opportunity to be here tonight. Holy Spirit, I admit that I need you every day of my life. And Lord, I thank you that tonight it's not of my words, Lord, it's not about me. But Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus that it's the Holy Spirit that speaks to us, that teaches us, that directs us, and that leads us and guides us into your word, into your will. Lord, I pray that we would come tonight with open ears and open hearts to see and to understand and to hear your word, Lord, to accept it and to ponder upon it and think upon it, Lord, and reflect upon it throughout the course of this week, that we might grow stronger and closer to you in our relationships. And Father, we thank you for all that you've done here at this church. And Lord, all the miraculous stories and all the accounts of blessing that we've seen in this house. And Lord, we thank you for the blessings that you've given to us and that we ask upon ourselves. But Lord, we don't ever ask those blessings just on us. We thank you for all of the churches across the Inland Empire that are meeting tonight here in the gospel of Jesus Christ and throughout the course of this week. God, I ask that you would bless them. Lord, Holy Spirit, we ask that you would speak to them as we ask that you would speak to us, Lord, because we are brothers and sisters working together to build your kingdom for your glory. We acknowledge that we cannot do this. We cannot reach our city. We cannot reach our family and our friends and our workplaces and the areas of our influence just by ourselves. But Lord, we need you and we need each other to build this kingdom for you. And so, Father, we thank you that you would speak to us tonight. Move in this place, Holy Spirit. And I thank you that as we walk out of this place, we would be encouraged and strengthened and equipped to be and to do your work for your glory. So, Father, to you be the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said,
amen.
Amen. Well, tonight I think it's a good message, a fun message. I was thinking about what to call it. It's always probably one of the hardest parts of preparing a message is, what do you title it? You know, you want to give it something kind of catchy, something kind of ringy, so that way when you think about it throughout the course of this week, it comes to mind. Why? Because I hope that you don't come to church to hear somebody talk and then walk out of this place and forget. Why? Because that's really not effective in learning and in growing in the ways of God. Ultimately, we're here to hear the word of God so that we could take it home and get it into our system so that we could be who God has called us to be. And so I was thinking about a title, and I decided tonight I would call the message Luchadores. Fighters. Luchadores. Did I say it right? Is that acceptable? Did I get the accent in there all right? Because otherwise I'd be like Luchadores. All right. When you look up that word, when I looked it up and I entered it into the translate module of Google to make sure that I was accurate, literally it means fighters, to fight. You see, each and every one of us were luchadores for the kingdom of God. As a matter of fact, to further emphasize that, Elijah, my friend, helped me out with a prop that I thought that I would just preach the rest of tonight in. Now, I don't know if you can actually receive the word of God. All right. Is my hair all right? Okay, got a little cowlick. Pulling a Pastor Dan there, huh? Amen. Listen, we're all called to fight. Luchadores are fighters, are wrestlers, are contenders. And you see, in our walk with God, we are all called to fight. I remember growing up, I think, in the heyday of wrestling, back when it was actually WWF. Some of you know what I'm talking about. I remember watching wrestling on TV in the morning, and I remember watching the heydays of the heroes, the big guys like Randy the Macho Man Savage, before it was step into a Slim Jim, it was step into the ring. And I remember guys like Hulk Hogan, and even in the early 90s and in the late 80s, Andre the Giant, and some of the great wrestlers of the 90s and in the 80s. And I remember I couldn't wait for Saturday to come along, and I would turn on that TV, and there he would be, the Hulk, in his red and in his yellow, or Macho Man with his bandana. And they would be there in the ring, and then there was that poor, unsuspecting guy. You know what I'm talking about? He always had like a blue or a purple like leotard kind of dress suit on, like wrestling suit on. And the poor guy was trying to make his debut into the world of entertainment wrestling, and through the course of the match, he was contorted and twisted into all sorts of ungodly ways. And there at the end of that match, the poor guy was left unconscious as the hero wrestler made his triumphant exit. And then one day I found out, I'm not gonna say it, that it was all rehearsed. For the wrestling fans, I won't call it fake, because I know some wrestlers and they have had serious injuries. And so with that being said, it's not fake, but at the same time, it's maybe orchestrated, choreographed, entertained. Anyways, we may not all relate to TV wrestling, but the truth of the matter is that each and every one of us wrestle in our lives. You may not get in the ring with the spandex suit on. You may not have your luchadora's mask. Well, some of you may, because obviously I got one tonight. But what you do on your own time is your... We may not all wrestle like that, but we all wrestle. Let's be honest with it. We all contend. We all fight. We all go through battles. We all go through hardships. We all face trials. We wrestle with ideas. We wrestle with thoughts. We wrestle with emotions. We wrestle with people. Amen. Sometimes we even wrestle with God. Man, I just don't have the answer. I don't know why I'm feeling this way. I don't know what to do. And we go back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. And we wrestle. We fight. We contend. Today I want to talk to you. I want to take you to a story in the Bible of a man in the Bible who literally wrestled with God. If you've got your Bibles, go with me to the book of Genesis in the 32nd chapter. As you're turning there, I'll ask you this question. Have you ever felt overwhelmed? Have you ever felt at any point in your time, maybe you're in that season right now, maybe you've gone there, but maybe there was a point in your time where it seems like the stuff just kept piling on you, like it just wouldn't stop, like something happened, and then all of a sudden something else happened, and then all of a sudden something else happened, and then somebody said something, and somebody did something. It's just like it didn't stop. It just kept going and going and going and going until you just felt like, I got nothing left to give. I got nothing left to do. I got nothing left to say. I literally feel like I'm gonna pop. Has anybody ever been there? This is a time in Jacob's life, I wholly believe, that he was at that point. You see, Jacob was in a lot of turmoil in this place, in this time. He had been working for his father-in-law, and he made a business arrangement with his father-in-law to build his own business, to build his own herd, and to build his own livestock. And in doing so, God had blessed him, and his father-in-law became very content and angry with Jacob at the time. And he had to leave because there was a lot of contention, a lot of bad blood in the relationship. And so God called him and he says, I want you to go back to the land of your fathers. I'll lead you. I'll be with you. So Jacob is leaving his family, everything that he's known for the past 14 years of his life. There he is, and he's leaving everything he knows, and he's got this contention on the inside. And so he goes on this journey that God is taking him back to the land of his fathers. And he gets word that his brother Esau, if you remember the story of Jacob and Esau, it was the younger brother to Esau, and Jacob there tricked his brother into giving him his birthright through giving him a bowl of stew when he was really hungry. I mean, it must have been really hungry to have that happen to you. And then he goes on and he tricks his father, he deceives his father to receive Esau's inheritance by dressing as his brother. And so his brother, upon hearing of this, swears to himself, promises to himself, puts it in his heart that he is going to kill his brother Jacob for this deceit, for this betrayal, for this backstabbing, so to say. And so here Jacob is leaving on this contention, and now all of a sudden he gets word that Esau is in town, gets word that Jacob is traveling, and Esau is on his way. Jacob's freaking out. I mean, he's literally freaking out. He's talking to his servants. He's like, what are we going to do? You know, Esau's going to kill me. He's going to take me. He says, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to take all of my servants, the 400 of you, everybody that's around me. I want 200 of you guys to go hang over behind this hill and just hide out. And 200 of you say, you know what? We are Jacob's servants. And if Esau slaughters you, well, then the other 200, y'all run, okay? Like, I would hate to be the first 200, right? So Jacob's, he's stressing. He has his family with him. He's got a lot of pressure. And so the Bible tells us that Jacob takes his family and he leads them across this ford of the river. And he leaves them over and he takes them to this place. And then Jacob returns back to this place. And the next day he's about to meet his brother. And everything's just piling on him. Everything's just there. It's just like that moment where you feel like you're going to pop. And the Bible says that Jacob went to go be alone. And there Jacob is alone. And probably one of the more unique and mysterious stories in the Bible happens here in Genesis in the 32nd chapter. Genesis in the 32nd chapter. Look what it says. Genesis chapter 32, beginning in verse number 24, it says, "Then Jacob was left alone." He went to be alone. You know what? I've got a big day ahead of me. I want to get my family, make sure that they're going to be safe. And then I want to get with God. Have you ever been that way before? Man, I just want to be alone right now. Don't talk to me. Let me get my head together. And it's like, no matter what you do, you can't get alone. Jacob's in this place. He says he went to be alone. And a man wrestled with him until the breaking of day. Here he is. Everything is happening at the wrong place at the wrong time. This man is literally afraid for his life, afraid for his family's life. Jacob wasn't the fighter. His brother Esau was the hunter, was the rough man of the family. Jacob knew that when it came head to head, man, it wasn't gonna happen. But here all of a sudden is a story of Jacob wanting to be alone, and a man wrestled with him until the breaking of day. And it goes on. "Now when he saw that he did not prevail against him, he touched the socket of his hip," this man. Now, if you'll notice in your Bible, if you have a New King James Bible, the "his" or "he" is all capitalized because as Hosea begins to say later on that Jacob was wrestling with an angel. Some people believe that Jacob was wrestling with the Lord, but Hosea specifically says that he was wrestling with an angel. And so here we see that the angel, this supernatural being, was wrestling with Jacob. And while Jacob and him were fighting throughout the course of the night, he could not win. So he touches the socket of Jacob's hip. And all of a sudden the Bible says that his hip was out of joint as he wrestled him. And he said, "Let me go," the angel's crying out to Jacob. "Let me go, for the day breaks." But Jacob says, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he, the angel, said, "What is your name?" Jacob says, "Jacob." And he said, "You shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel. For you have struggled with God and with men and have prevailed." Right there, that's the statement I want to focus on. In this fight, the angel says to Jacob, "You have struggled, you have strived, you have wrestled with God and with men, and you have prevailed." You see, God's desire for us is to prevail. He doesn't want you beat down, tore up, living in depression and anxiety and defeat all the days of your life. This is a message for you and a message for me. That we have struggled with God, we have strived with God and with men, but at the end of our lives, let it be said about each and every one of us that we have prevailed. Because God has called us, as the Bible tells us in the book of Romans, to be more than conquerors through Christ Jesus. To prevail through those things that you're wrestling with. Those emotions, those feelings, that idea that you just can't quite get out of your head, that question, that struggle, that family member, or that issue that you're going on, or that thing that you've been holding on to strive with it, but to prevail, to win against it, to continue on. You have wrestled with God and men and have prevailed. Jacob asks, saying, "Tell me your name, I pray." And he says, "Why do you want to know my name?" And he blessed him there. So Jacob called the place Peniel. Literally means, "I have seen God face to face, and my life is preserved." Just as he crossed over Penuel, the sun rose on him, and he limped on his hip. Jacob is a unique story, kind of weird, almost like a segue to the story of Jacob meeting his brother Esau, to find out only that Esau greets him and warms him and is reunited with his brother. But in this course of turmoil, this unique segue, this short section of scripture, this real kind of mysterious passage tells us that Jacob wrestled with God. The Bible tells us that he wrestled with men and that he prevailed. And I believe that there's something to say here about wrestling. And I want to talk about the subject of wrestling first and foremost with God, and also talk about wrestling with others and with other things. Because I think that there are seasons in our lives in which we do both. And today I want to look at this, and the lesson to be learned here, I think, with Jacob is that it's a spiritual lesson of Jacob's life. The angel fought Jacob as a man. Now, if this angel wanted to be an angel, we know, because we have seen what angels have done in other battles, that this angel could have easily overpowered Jacob. But he fought Jacob as a man. Interesting. But as a man, he could not win, so the angel touches his hip and cripples his hip. The muscles, the Bible says, shrank around his hip, and he limped out. You see, Jacob had an injury. He was crippled in the fight, but yet he still prevailed. When it comes to wrestling God, it's going to humble you. Wrestling God is going to humble you. You see, whenever we go to battle with God, whenever we wrestle with God, whenever we contend with God, there's always going to be some type of crippling, some type of death, death to your ego, death to your pride, death to your will, because God prevails. But you see, wrestling with God is not always a bad thing. Jacob left that fight with a limp, but he also left with a new name. And here Jacob was worried. God said to Jacob before he left, "I'll be with you on this journey." But Jacob seemed to have forgotten that through his stress, through his anxiety, through worrying about what his brother was going to do and the safety and the happiness of his family. Jacob was so caught up in the moment. And yet in this moment when I want to just get together and clear my head and go over all the scenarios that Esau might say to me and what he might do to me, let me just take a moment and reflect on it. Their opposition comes again, but this time, godly opposition. They say, "You know what, Jacob? I said I'd be with you. Let's fight. Let's spar. Let's put on the mask and the gloves and let's go 15 in the ring. Let's see how it goes." And Jacob there held on the entire night. At the end of the fight, at the end of the course of the battle, at the end of wrestling, yes, Jacob left with a limp. Some people believe that Jacob limped all of his life because the Bible tells us that at the end of Jacob's life, he leaned on his staff. But that could very well just mean that Jacob was an old man and he leaned on his staff. But nonetheless, Jacob walked away from the battle with a limp. But he also left with a new name. You see, when you go to wrestle with God, and it's God's season to wrestle with you, did you notice that God initiated this fight? That there was somebody there to wrestle with Jacob. You don't read in this mysterious story that Jacob took his family to one side of the river, and then he crossed back over and he started screaming at God, like Gary Sinise and Forrest Gump during the hurricane, saying, "Come on, give me your best!" But yet, God was there. It was a season, a learning lesson to wrestle, to work it out, to figure out the season of his life. And at the end of this, Jacob prevailed against an angel. You know, leaving prevailing against an angel and being blessed by God, when you're about to face another fight the next day, you're going to feel pretty good about yourself. But you see, wrestling with God is always going to be a humbling experience, but that's not a bad thing. I remember there was a season in my life, I've gone through quite a few seasons of wrestling with God. I remember there was a time in my life when I was exercising my faith as a young believer, and my wife and I was our first real battle of faith, and we were walking, and man, it just never panned out. Seems like God didn't show up, God didn't work his, you know, didn't answer our prayers, didn't work in our lives, didn't work on our behalfs, and I was really upset. I was really bitter. I was really mad at God, and so I wrestled with God. I wrestled with my beliefs. It was me and God. I'll tell you what, I walked out of that a lot more humble. I'm here today to say, you know what? I walked out of that fight. I walked out of that wrestle a different person. Why? Because God revealed to me things about me that I didn't yet know. Things about me that I didn't yet understand. Jacob, his name was Supplanter. Jacob came out holding onto his brother's wrist. Jacob was always second best. Jacob was the musician, while Esau was the rough man, the hairy guy, the hunter, the provider. Jacob was always the inferior, but the angel says to Jacob, "What's your name?" And Jacob says, "Jacob." And he says, "You'll no longer be called Supplanter, second best. You'll no longer be known as the inferior. Your new name shall be Israel, which means he who strives with God, which means Prince of God. You see, Jacob, his identity was changed in that match. Maybe you're in a season of your life where you're wondering, you're questioning, you're pursuing and you're seeking out, and you feel like maybe you're wrestling with God about something in your life. And that's okay. It's not something to be afraid of. It's not something to run from, but to understand that wrestling with God will humble you. But even though Jacob walked out with a limp, he walked out with a new name. A new name. A name that changed his identity, that changed everything about him. No longer was he second best. Now he was Israel, to which we know was the father of the nations, the tribes. See, God had a plan. So wrestling with God will humble you. But you know what? God's desire is not for us to spend our days wrestling him. Those are seasons, I believe. Those are special areas of our lives, special occasions in which God says, you know what? We got to work this out, you and I. We got to come together, and God says, I want to show you some things about you. I want to tell you some things about you. It's not going to be easy for you. It's going to hurt. You're going to limp. But I'm going to show you something. I'm going to give you a new identity. I'm going to give you a new perspective. But you see, each and every day of our lives, we do walk out another fight. And that is wrestling before God or in the presence of God. Wrestling before God builds us up and gives us strength. We don't wrestle in our own power and our own ability. We don't wrestle against other people physically, because the Bible tells us, Paul says, for we do not wrestle, you know the scripture, against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities. So you see, our wrestling before God, in the presence of God, is what builds us and strengthens us. Why? Because it is a spiritual fight that we fight every day, church. There's a special season that God has for us, I believe, to wrestle with him, to find our identity in him. But each and every day of our walks, we have to put on the mask and wrestle before God in his presence. The Bible says we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, a stadium of people who have come before and who are cheering you and I on, saying, you can do this. Wrestling before God will build you. If you've got your Bibles, we're going to play around in the New Testament for a little while. Go with me to the book of 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians in the 9th chapter. Paul the Apostle uses this word. I want to take you there. I'll show it to you. 1 Corinthians in the 9th chapter. Verse number 25, very familiar section of scripture, but I wanted to show this to you. Verse number 25, 1 Corinthians of the 9th chapter. He says, and everyone who competes. Do you know what that word translated also means? Fights. Wrestles. Strives. So we have this picture of runners, because he talks about run in such a way. The previous verses, he says, run that you might obtain an imperishable crown. Now he says, everyone who competes, that word literally means fights. Everyone who fights, everyone who wrestles, everyone who strives, everyone who contends, for the prize is temperate in all things. They do it to obtain a perishable crown, but we for an imperishable crown, he says. But I discipline, thus I run not with uncertainty, thus I fight. There it is again. I fight, I contend, I war, I wrestle, I spar, I strive, he says. Not as somebody who beats the air. He goes on, but I discipline my body and I bring it into subjection, lest when I have preached to others, I myself should become disqualified. See, Paul says, listen, I understand in the physical world that if I'm going to be a fighter, I got to build myself up. I can't go 15 rounds with Floyd Mayweather, right? Without working out, without developing my skills, without getting stronger, right? You've seen them before. The guys who came in the ring with Mike Tyson, or those poor wrestlers hoping to make their debut in their blue jumpsuit against the Hulk, twisted and contorted and left unconscious. He says, that's not me, because I know that in my fight, I'm going to have to fight. I'm going to have to discipline myself. I'm going to have to build myself up. I'm going to have to wrestle. I'm going to have to face resistance. And in resistance, I am made stronger, not resistance based on my own ability. Because when you wrestle without the presence of God, that does not make you stronger. That makes you weaker. But when we wrestle before God, meaning God is there before us, we are in His presence with His blessing, with His power, with His tools, with His training. We are made stronger, church, in our weakness. So when we wrestle with these ideas, when we wrestle with these emotions, when we wrestle with these thoughts that tell us that are things that are contrary to the Word of God, when we wrestle against people who are buffeting us and challenging us and trying us and persecuting us, when we wrestle against problems and trials and hard times, you see, when we do this in the presence of God, it makes us stronger, because we realize that resistance, that striving, that pressing, that fighting will only build us, because we have God. You see, the hard part about this is the greatest device the enemy has, I think, especially against Christians, is to confuse, to bring confusion. Have you ever been so mad, been so full of anger, so full of frustration, so full of emotion that when somebody who was totally and completely unrelated as to why you were mad said something or did something, you exploded on them? I remember I was just in college. We had just moved away. I was 17 years old. It was my first time living away from home. And after a couple of weeks, everybody was working. Everybody was happy. Everybody was laughing. And I was the jobless, desperate Bible college student waiting on God to answer my prayers. And I remember one day, I don't even remember the circumstances about it, but it was like I felt like everybody got around me and had an intervention on my behalf. And I popped. You ever been there before? Just popped. And praise God, he's still my friend, but many of you know Pastor Joe, who's our youth pastor across the way in the youth auditorium right now. Pastor Joe was just in the way of my finger, if you know what I mean. Not like that. I just needed somebody to put it on. And I remember I saw him. He was standing in the doorway watching this young boy just explode with emotion and confusion. And I remember I just lashed out at him and said all sorts of venomous and horrible things about him. And to this day, he still says, man, you remember when you said that about me? And I'm like, man. Had nothing to do with him. But you see, the devil's devices are just like that. There are seasons in which God wants us to contend with Him, to develop ourselves, to see, to be revealed that we're no longer the supplanter, but now we are He who strives with God and prevails. Those are seasons. But for our day-to-day lives, we are to wrestle before God in His presence. But you see, I think the devil's greatest device is to confuse the church, so that we, like me when I was a young kid, point our finger at somebody who's totally unrelated. We begin to bicker and battle back and forth. We begin to put the blame of our problems onto somebody else. They're the source of my problems. They're the reason everything's happening to me. They're the reason I'm feeling this way. Or even more so, he confuses us so much so as to say, God is the reason for my problems. Maybe you've been there before, asking yourself, God, where are you? Why aren't you listening to me? I pray and I ask you to deliver me from this, and it seems like you don't answer. It seems like you don't care. It seems like you're not there. What is going on? And we begin to get mad at God because he's not showing up. And the reason he's not showing up is because instead of battling or wrestling the issue, we're wrestling God. And all along, the devil's sitting on the sidelines. He was the one whose name was on the docket for the fight, but yet he created confusion on the inside of us by focusing our attention on somebody completely unrelated so that we would not show up to our fight. Paul the Apostle, and I got you in 1 Corinthians. Go with me to 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians in the 12th chapter. This is a familiar verse. It's about the thorn in the flesh. Paul the Apostle in 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter. He says, unless, verse number 7, as you turn it, I'll read there, and you can get there because the meat's further down. But he says in verse number 7, and least I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations. A thorn in the flesh was given to me. A messenger of Satan to buffet me. Has anybody ever had a messenger of Satan sent to buffet them in their lives? Man, I tell you what, it's just like you can't get rid of them. They follow you. They pop out of the corner just when you don't want them to be there. They have that voice, or they have that saying, or they have that phrase, or they have that look, or they have those words. They just keep coming and coming and coming. And maybe you feel like, man, that messenger of Satan was my parents that told me I'd never amount to anything. Or a school teacher, or somebody on the streets, or a coworker who nonstop picks on me and persecutes me and won't leave me alone. Paul says, I had that. I had a messenger of Satan who was sent to buffet. You know what buffet means? To wear me out, to grind me down over and over and over and over again. Contention, battle, fighting, striving. Paul was in this place. He says, concerning this thing, I pleaded with God 3 times that it might depart from me. 3 times I pleaded. See that word pleaded? That's more than just like, God, I got this issue and I need you to help. Pleading is, God, I need you. Where are you? Please, please. He says, I pleaded with God 3 times. That's contention. It's argument. That's wrestling. It's battling. It's striving. But look at his answer. He says, the Lord said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. My strength is made perfect in weakness. So the Bible goes on and tells us that Paul says, therefore, I will continue to strive with God until he removes it from me. I'll continue to wrestle with God until he takes this away from me. Does Paul say that? Is anybody in 2 Corinthians 12 chapter? It's real easy. Look at verse number 10 and then answer that question. Does Paul say, I will continue, therefore, I will continue to wrestle with God? No. Man, y'all, are you here? Does Paul say, I will continue to wrestle with God?
No.
Whatever. Therefore, I take pleasure in my infirmities, in reproaches, in needs, in persecution, in distresses for Christ's sake. Why? For when I am weak, then I am strong. You see, Paul says, my fight wasn't with God. I was contending. I pleaded 3 times. 3 times. And all the while, this messenger has not let up. The devil's trying to point him. Why isn't God answering your question? Why isn't he there? Maybe he doesn't care about you. Maybe you're not praying hard enough or loud enough. You're just not a good enough person. You've made too many mistakes. And all of a sudden, he's redirecting the fight from him to God. But Paul says, no, no, my fight is with the devil. And therefore I realize that in persecutions, in weakness, in hardships, and in infirmities, and in suffering for Jesus' sake, I'm going to be glad about it. Why? Because when I am weak, I am wrestling before God. And I know that my coach is right there on the side of the ring, screaming at me, hollering at me, saying, you can do it. You can do it. Keep going. Keep pressing. Keep fighting. Don't let go. Don't let up. Put the devil in an arm bar. You can do it. Because when I am weak, I am strong. So we got to realize that every day we're going to wrestle. Every day you're going to wrestle, but like Deborah Smith Spigay said on Sunday with that puppet, your fight's not against the person that's bringing you problems. Let's not be so naive as to think that people are the motivation. There is an unseen world that we wrestle with every day that directs and motivates those around us to do and to say either what God or what the devil will have. And so your fight is not with that person who persecutes you. Paul's fight, his wrestle, was not in the thorn. His wrestle was with the devil, with the thoughts, with the ideas, with the persecutions. His wrestle was against the spiritual things of this world. Not that person. Not that denomination. Not that pastor. Not that book. Not this or that. Our fight is against the devil. But his greatest device, I think, to us, and when it comes to fighting, is to confuse us so that we end up fighting each other and we end up fighting God. And all along, he sits back, fat and happy, because he doesn't have to get into it. But church, that's not God's desire. Because we wrestle with God and we wrestle with men and we prevail. To go beyond, to be successful. But today I'm not going to leave you with a how-to. Well, how do you fight? How do you wrestle? You know why I'm not going to leave you with the how-to? Because you don't become a black belt when you go to orientation in karate. I went to karate class one day, I'm a black belt. You are not a master in a day. A how-to message will not make you a master on how to fight. But like any discipline, dedication, the word, the church, the teaching, in and out and in and out and in and out, all throughout the course of the week, all throughout the course of your life, and all of a sudden you'll look back and you say, I am a ninja warrior for Jesus. But today I will leave you with this. What do you do? Not how do you do, but what do you do? How do you do it? You come to church and get the word. That's how you do it. What do you do? It's really easy. It's really easy. You ready? Show up. Pray up. And don't give up. Show up. Pray up. And don't give up. Show up. Pray up. And don't give up. That's what we do. First and foremost, show up. You got to show up to the fight. You actually have to get in the ring. Just like Jacob in his story. The Bible doesn't say that a man came to wrestle with Jacob and he screamed and ran across the river. Right? It says that Jacob wrestled until the break of day. Jacob was like, you want to go? Let's go. I'm ready. When the devil comes knocking at your door, for your children, for your thoughts, for your emotions, for the things that are going on in your life with your coworkers or your friends or the people that are around you, you have got to show up to the fight. Otherwise, you're forfeiting it and letting him win. And far too many Christians today are beat up from pillar to post, knocked around all the course of their life, wondering, why isn't God doing anything in my life? And all the while he's saying, I want you to wrestle before me, which means you gotta show up to the fight. I love what Paul the Apostle says in 2 Timothy. He says, fight, or 1 Timothy, he says, fight the good fight. You know what you gotta do to fight the good fight? You gotta fight. He didn't say, watch the good fight of faith. He didn't say, come to church and let your pastor fight your fight. You have to fight your fight. But too many of us, we look at our lives spiraling down the drain and we say, I can't. And all the time God says, get in there. Holds the rope open for us in the ring. Come on, I got you. I'm right here. Because wrestling before God makes us strong. My little boy Bjorn, he's pretty young, but my wife decided to put him in soccer. It drives me nuts. Because he cries. He's a shy guy. I mean, he's a mama's boy. He hangs on to mama's leg and he screams and cries whenever she's not around. And so there we're at soccer practice and he's screaming, holding on to mama's leg, I can't. And it's like, yes, you can. Literally, you can let go and walk 20 feet over and kick the soccer ball. You can do that. You really can do that. But that's us. That's us. We're holding on to our previous life. We're holding on to ourselves. We're holding on to our pride, screaming and crying, saying, I can't, when God is saying, yes, you can. You strive with God and men and prevail. Got to show up. You got to pray up. See, that's what I was talking about, the war room. I didn't even see that movie before I wrote it. It's all about prayer. You know, we like to think, remember that commercial? It was a commercial a couple years back. Little kid had a Darth Vader helmet on. It was a Volkswagen commercial. And he was walking around everything trying to like make it move, right? Remember that? And then dad came home and it was all about the remote start for the Volkswagen. The kid walks out to the Volkswagen and like holds up his hand and dad's in the kitchen. He hits the turn on button, the car revs, and the kid's like, looks at his hands. You know, we'd like to think that there's this like cosmic force in the world from all living beings that's either good or bad, and that we can use that to will and to move and to get things going. But that's movies. But there is a cosmic force in the world, a force that moves mountains, that changes the course of light and destiny. That cosmic force is prayer. It's not this weak thing. It's not this, you know, mellow and backed up, you know, little remote type, God, please. It's a fight. It's a contention. My mom is my prayer hero warrior. If you've ever seen Pastor Debbie outside of the pulpit, she is meek and timid and humble. But if you have ever seen that woman pray, OMG, I don't want to go after her. Because she's a warrior. Prayer is not timid, it's not weak. The Bible says that the fervent prayers availeth much. Look what Paul says. I'll just put it up on the overhead in Colossians in the 4th chapter. He's talking about his friend in the New International Version. It translates this Greek word. He says, Epaphras, who is one of you and a servant of Christ Jesus, sends greetings. He is always wrestling in prayer for you. He's fighting in prayer for you. Maybe there's somebody in your life that you need to go to battle for. Maybe it is that person that's persecuting you, that person that's making your life a living hell at work or at school. Maybe it's somebody that you know and that you love and you just want to see them come to Jesus. He is always wrestling in prayer for you. Church, it's time for us to pray up, to show up and to pray up. Like that movie show that when the pastor walked into the room and he was like, man, it's baked onto the walls in here that somebody was praying. That ought to be us. And I say us because I'm talking about me. That ought to be us. If we got more prayed up in our lives, what could we accomplish? You see, God doesn't want just a few prayer warriors to carry his entire church through life. He wants his entire church to become prayer warriors. We got to show up. We got to pray up. And also, don't give up. Don't give up. The Bible says that Jacob contended with the man, the angel, through the entire night. Even after he touched him, the Bible says that he wrestled him with a lame hip. Jacob did not give up. Yet something happens to us. We're praying and things go south. Well, I guess it didn't work. We're praying for somebody and they get worse. Well, I guess I shouldn't do that. Well, God, I feel better today. And then tomorrow comes, my life is a disaster again. I guess it's just not for me. And we give up. We give up. We give in. But he says, your name shall no longer be supplanter, but Israel. He who contends with God and man and prevails. Wins. Succeeds, but you don't succeed if you quit. If you give up or you give in. The fight's hard. You might be in a season of injury or of scarring. You might have a limp. That's okay. Don't let the limp stop you. Don't give up. Paul the Apostle in Colossians, and I'll conclude on this. Colossians in the fourth chapter, or the first chapter, I'm going to go ahead and put it up on the overhead for you guys. Colossians in the first chapter, Paul says, I rejoice in my sufferings, and I fill up my flesh, which is lacking in the afflictions of Christ, for the sake of his body, which is the church. He goes on and he says, of which I became a minister according to the stewardship from God, which was given to me for you to fulfill the word of God. The word of God was given to me for you. What is the word of God? Verse number 26. The mystery which has been hidden from the ages, from generations, but has now been revealed to us, the saints. What is it? Verse number 27. To them, God willed to make known what are the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles. God wants all. He wants all. He says, it's my mission, my life's purpose, my fight, my struggles, my afflictions are coming at the calling of my life to tell the world that God loves them, that Jesus died for them, and that they too can be successful and conquerors and find joy and happiness and be free from sin. Paul says, this is my mission, my fight, the hope of glory. But look what he says. In him we preach, warning every man and teaching every man all the wisdom that we present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. And he says, verse number 29, to this end, I also labor, striving. You see that word striving? Same word Paul talked about as contending, competing, fighting. To this end, I labor, fighting according to his working, which works in me mightily. Paul says, I'm not going to give up. I'm not going to back down. I'm not going to stray away. I'm not going to let go. I'm going to press. I'm going to be like Jacob with that angel that says, I will not let go until you bless me. I will not be defeated. Amen. You know, growing up with dad, you've heard Pastor Jimmy talks about boxing all the time. Well, naturally, then we grew up with the Rocky movies. Remember Rocky? Back when Sylvester Stallone was cool. Man, Rocky IV. Remember that? Some of the guys in the house against Ivan Drago.
I will break you.
Remember that? Heart's on fire. Remember Rocky's running through the snow? And there he is in the battle in Russia. Nobody's rooting for him. Nobody's cheering for him. And Ivan Drago has literally killed his best friend, Apollo Creed. And now he's fighting him, and Rocky is getting it handed to him. But you remember Apollo's coach? Remember that scene? I think it was in the third round. Rocky's beat up his face, Sylvester Stallone. Remember his coach? He comes up to him and he grabs his head. He says, you can do it.
I'm gonna do it. You can do it. I'm gonna do it. No pain, no pain, no pain, no pain, no pain.
Remember that? And at the end of the fight, Ivan Drago says, this man is like steel. He hits so hard. And you remember the end of the story? At the end of that fight in Rocky IV, all of Russia is rooting for Rocky. Why? Because the Italian Stallion never gave up. That's you. Nobody may be rooting for you in your fight. Nobody may support you in your battle. You might be fighting alone, but remember when you wrestle before God, you get stronger. Because you've got Jesus in your corner, holding you when you can't hold on any longer. Putting the ice over your swollen cuts and saying, no pain, no pain, no pain, no pain, no pain, no pain, no pain. No pain. Why? Because you can do it. But you got to show up. You got to pray up. Most of all, don't give up. Don't give up. Because every day we're going to wrestle. Every day we're faced with things that will draw our attention away from God, that will take our eyes off of Jesus, that will fix our issues and our focus onto somebody else who's not the problem. And every day we got to wake up and we got to decide to get in the ring, get into our prayer and say, I'm not going to give up on this fight. It may not be going in my favor. It may not be working in my direction, but I'm not going to give up. And we're going to choose to fight. And we're going to battle. And we're going to war. And we're going to prevail. Because that is what God desires for your life. You don't have to be bound by those thoughts that come back to you and tell you you're worthless. You don't have to be beat up by those memories of what somebody said. You don't have to be dragged around by the chains of your afflictions and your bondages. Because Jesus Christ has made you more than a conqueror. And there are far too many Christians in our day and age that are in the stadium watching the fight. When God says, no, that's my job. And the cloud of witnesses' job. Your job is to get in the ring. To get on those ropes. To put the devil in an arm bar through prayer. And when it seems like you're getting twisted, don't give up. Because you will prevail. You can do it. You guys got something out of the Word of God? Give the Lord a great big praise today. Man, it's crazy. It was like a Sunday morning exodus. I don't know if like hundreds of people left, but you know what? There's speakers out there, and I just want to talk to you that left. You know, I understand it's a school night, it's a work night, and you got to get out there, and you want to beat the traffic, and you want to get out there, but listen, especially to those of you that know what we're about to do, it's just downright rude and disrespectful to what God is going to do in the people's lives around you for you to get up and encourage people to leave. And I want to encourage you, when you come to church, to give your heart over to God. Forget traffic. It's sacrifice. But if you're not going to make sacrifices for God in your life, in church, come on, guys, let's get serious about this today. So I want to encourage you as you leave and as you exit, those of you who have left early, this is not the time and the place to do that. It's not leave early. It's not get out of here. It's not the mass exodus. Why? Because God wants to speak to people, and perhaps and potentially you who left, God has something he wants to say to you, but you're missing it. And it's not on my hands. It's on yours. Today, I want to just talk to you for a moment. I'm going to let you out. I promise I'll get you out on time. There are those of you in this place today that you have not yet got in the ring. You're fighting a fight and you have been beat up all your life. You feel like there is something going on in your life. There is an emptiness. There is a void on the inside of you. And you are wondering and searching and seeking out what is the answer. And today, I want to give you the opportunity. The Bible says that a man ought to examine himself from time to time. And I want you to answer this question in your heart. If you were to leave today and you were to die, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? Because how you arrive at that answer, how you come to your conclusion, has a lot to say about your position with God. And let me tell you something. There's nothing in the Word of God that says that you can hope that you're going to get to heaven. There's nowhere in the Word of God that says you can think or you can desire. There's nowhere in God's Word that says because you sit in church means that you're in the fight, that you're a conqueror. Well, I hear the pastor preach and I amen when he got real sweaty and veins were popping out of his neck. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you sit in church and hear somebody preach, because you carry your Bible or you even read it from time to time, nowhere in the Bible does it say that that's going to get you into heaven. Well, but pastor, I was baptized or christened as a baby. I went to Sunday school classes. I'm involved. I'm a member of a church. Did you know that nowhere in God's Word does it say that because you're a member, because you were baptized, because you were christened as a child, because your parents told you, gave you the title of Christian, that means you're going to get to heaven? The census comes knocking on your door and you answer Christian. Did you know that nowhere does it say that you give yourself a title? Man, we love to label ourselves in our day and age. But nowhere does it say that you can label yourself a Christian and that's good. Well, I'm not a Buddhist or a Hindu or a Muslim or anything else. I always thought that meant that I was right with God. Wrong. You see, you can't work for it. You can't earn it. You can't buy it. You don't deserve to go to heaven. But that doesn't have to be the answer. It doesn't have to be the final solution for your life. Why? Because it's not about our deeds. It's not about our church attendance. It's not about our mindset. It's not about our hopes, our wishes, our desires. The only way we can get to God's heaven is God's way. The Bible says that we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, which means the only way we can get there, we all come up short. The only way we can get there is God's way. But Jesus is that way. Jesus says that he is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one goes to the Father except through him. So today I want to give you God's way. I want to give you the opportunity to accept the gift of salvation. You see, the Bible says that the gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. It's a gift. And like any gift that you get on your birthday or Christmas or for a special occasion, you have a choice. You can either accept that gift or you can reject it or return it. God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He's not going to force his way or make his way in. Somebody once said, well, if God wants me, he'll take me. No, God's already done everything he could by giving Jesus for you. It's time for you and I to accept the truth, to see it for what it really is, that we can't get to heaven our own way, our own desires, our own wishes, our own wants. The only way we can get to heaven is through Jesus. And Jesus says these words in John the 3rd chapter. In order to see the kingdom of heaven, you must be born again. What does that mean, born again? Born again, we think, well, that's that weirdo, crazy, out of control Christianity. I've seen them in the movies. I know what you're talking about. You're talking about that crazy old lady that's always carrying her Bible and thumping it around. Listen, let me tell you something. From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, born again has always meant the same thing in the heart and the eyes of God. Here it is. It means that you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with God the Father through his Son, Jesus Christ. In the book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to his church and he says, listen, I'm coming back. And he says, I'd rather find that you're hot. I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, he says, I'll vomit you from my mouth. It's a shocking phrase from the mouth of Jesus, designed to get our attention. You see, Jesus was just talking to the church in that same passage of Scripture, and he says, you think that you've got it all together. You think that you look good with all the clothes that you have of splendor and that you're eating well, but he says, you don't realize that you're naked and destitute and starving. He says, oh, I wish that you would come to me. You see, we try to do life on our own. We try to find God on our own, but really, in reality, to God, no matter what we do, we're naked, destitute, and starving. Why? Because we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But Jesus came and he bridged that gap for you so that you and I could be full, could be clothed in splendor, royalty, adopted and grafted into God's family through Jesus. And it comes by accepting him into your heart, into your life. Jesus says these words. He says that if you confess him before men, he will confess you. Says, but if you deny him, he will deny you. Today, I want to give you that opportunity. I'm going to count to three. I'll go one, two, and on the count of three, I'll go three. I'm going to smack my hands. In a moment, when I smack my hands, I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, you know what? I want to give God my heart. I want to give God my life. I want to give him all of my life. I'm tired of living my life my way. I'm tired of trying to fill the emptiness on the inside of me with all the things that don't seem to work. The only thing that will fill that void on the inside of your life is Jesus. And it's time for you to start doing things God's way. You're making a decision. I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it. Put it right back down. Who should raise your hand? If you've never given your heart, you've never given your life to Jesus, if that's you in just a moment, get ready. Pop your hand up. If you're not sure, maybe you prayed the prayer once before in church or in your youth group, or you went to Harvest Crusade with Great Glory and you prayed that prayer. You even followed along with a TV pastor, but you've never really followed through with it. You've never really carried on with it. You say, man, I come into this place and I just don't feel like that's me, or I'm just not quite sure. Don't walk out of here tonight without making sure. God desires for you to prevail, to win, to go on. Maybe you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God's thing. Been running from God instead of to God. Listen, if that's you, come on, let's stop playing games. Let's stop messing around. Church isn't just a social club. It's not just a place where we can come and hoot and holler and have fun. It's a place to get fed so that we can get out into the real world and be who God has called us to be. But that comes by serving Jesus with all of our heart, with all of our life. Jesus says the thief doesn't come except to steal, kill, and destroy. The world is not out here to make you better. The world is out here to take away your life. But he says, I have come that you might have life, have it more abundantly. And it starts by accepting Jesus today. So wherever you are, whoever you are in this place, from the front row to the back row, from the side to side, for those of you that are left in the family rooms, maybe you're outside watching on the television, or you're hearing the sound of my voice because they left early, wherever you're at, don't let this opportunity pass you by. The Bible says that our life is a vapor. And today, you've had doctors and dentist appointments at the divine appointment. You're here for a reason right now, to surrender your heart, to surrender your life to Jesus, and to accept and to live life as God desires, full and fulfilled. It starts by accepting that gift of salvation. Today, wherever you're at, all across this auditorium, I'm going to count to three, and when I do, if that's you, I want you to pop your hand up. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down, and we'll go forward together from there. I don't care if you've been in this church for an hour or 26 years. Doesn't matter where you're at. This is your moment. This is your time. The time of your salvation is now. When I count to three, if that's you, get ready. Pop your hand up. Ready? When I count to three, here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place. One, two. I saw those hands right over there. Anybody else in this place? You say, man, I wonder if I should. Yes, come on. I know that you're in this place today. Where are you at? Contending. There you are, I see you. You're contending, you're wrestling, I get you. I understand. But it's time for you to accept life, to accept Jesus. Today, it's your choice. Anybody else in this place? Three wise people. Say, man, I wonder if I should. I wonder if I should. Yes, you should. Anybody else in this place today? All right, hey, your call, your choice. But today, I believe God's got some great and mighty things in store for you. Here's what we're going to do. We're all going to stand together. And those of you that raise your hand, there's a couple over here and a couple over here. Those of you that raise your hand, or maybe you didn't raise your hand, but you know it's you. You're wrestling on the inside right now saying, I just don't know if I can. This is your moment. This is your time. I want to encourage you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair, get into the aisle, and come meet me up here at this altar. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You get saved by giving your heart and life to Jesus. And we're going to do that together. You're making a decision. And every decision requires action. Let's all stand together as we do. Elijah's going to sing a song. If you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand, come on and meet me up here today. Let's change destinies together right here, right now, wherever you're at. This is your moment. Come on. If that's you in this place, you know that's you. You're wrestling with God. It's time to accept life.
You set me free. Thank you, Jesus.
Well, sister, praise God, you came. Give me a high five, girl. I'm just going to take a quick moment. There are more of you in this place. I can't make you. And as a matter of fact, I wouldn't even want to make you. It's too good. It's a path you got to walk. It's a choice you got to make. It's a fight you got to get into. And nobody can get you into it except for you. But when you do, you prevail. Maybe you're afraid. Say, I can't do this. I'm not sure. This is your moment. You're tired of living your life. I'm speaking by the Spirit of God. You're tired of living your life the way you are. You're tired of the results you're getting, and it's time for you to accept life. Like Jacob says, I won't let go until you bless me. It's time for you to let it go and let God. So I'm going to let Elijah sing that song, and I know you're in this place today. God is speaking to you. It's the goodness of God that draws men to repentance, the Bible says. It's not me. It's nothing to do with me. And if that's you in this place, I want you to get out of your seat. I want you to come and meet me up here today, because your life is going to change. But it starts by accepting the call of Jesus in your life. Elijah, would you go for it one more time, my friend?
Thank
come on.
Thank you, Jesus, for loving me. And thank you,
that's you. Come on.
Jesus,
be brave. You can do it. It's your time. It's your choice.
For
it's your calling.
Saving me. Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah, they're coming. You can come too.
You rescued me.
Praise God. You guys came. The Bible says that all of heaven rejoices when one person comes back to God. Did you know right now that there's a party in heaven for you? Right now, for you, in your name. It's awesome. Good job. Maybe nobody's told you in your life, good job. Congratulated you. But you know what? Today, good job. Making the very best decision you possibly can make. Not going to a funeral, right? Going to a birthday celebration. You're going to get born again today. Today's the first day of the rest of your lives. Here's what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? He's a really cool guy. Nothing weird goes on. Dude, seriously? I'm as weird as it's going to get, okay? I've take the cake for weirdness, okay? Nothing weird goes on. He's going to lead you guys in a prayer. He's going to give you some free information. And he's going to introduce you to a friend. get you connected, to build you up so that you can fight that fight, that you can get into the ring and you can be victorious. So if you guys just go to your left, my right, go right over there with Pastor Joel. Congratulations. Amen.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.